I'm delighted to welcome Thomas Cox, who's the Managing Director of the London Corinthia Hotel, to our podcast. I was really interested in talking to Thomas because I watched a TV program with him a few months ago where he was talking about the hotel and he was talking about aspiring to excellence and how that was really important through every single aspect of the hotel and what they do. And that really resonated with me because I think the seven skills are very much about aspiring to excellence, to really digging into the gold that is inside you and just being the very best person that you can be. So I thought it would be great to talk to somebody who has such a strong theme of excellence in their life and in their work. So I'm delighted to welcome Thomas Cox, the Managing Director of the Corinthia Hotel London, to the show. Welcome.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
Und ich freue mich sehr, Ihnen kennenzulernen.
Oh my God, you want to do this in German. Fantastic.
Oh, I don't think I can do
the whole... Es freut mich sehr, hier zu sein.
I'm sitting here with Thomas in this beautiful London suite. Absolutely gorgeous at the Corinthia Hotel. And I wanted to interview Thomas because I feel strongly that there is a real sense of excellence and wonder about this hotel. And I feel that you're driving it.
Thank you, I try.
I'd love to just ask you, what does that mean to you?
Well, I mean, excellence is, it's a very broad question, of course, but excellence for sure has something to do with trying to be a little bit better every day, doing the very best you can, maybe excelling a little bit at times, and also giving our guests just the best experience there can be. You know, I'm very aware in this business that there are a number of incredibly reputable and very, very good luxury five-star hotels in London. So in that landscape, of course, you need to somehow stand out. And excellence in the, you know, in the context of luxury is, of course, not very far-fetched. But the question is, of course, what is that excellence and how do you achieve it? Because if it becomes an exercise which is achingly sort of pursued, then I don't think it's very enjoyable. I really, in our world here, like to use the word effortless quite a bit, because if it's happening effortlessly, I think the outcome of excellence is truly excellent.
But you have a lot of people here to manage.
500,
wow,
roughly.
Okay. So how do you inspire that in them?
I mean, in hotels, it's just incredibly important to create a culture. It's really, it's a mindset. I very often get asked the question, not so Thomas, in hotels, what's the most outrageous request you ever had? And it's really a difficult question to answer because, first of all, there aren't that many outrageous requests. But, of course, with the years in hotels and in this environment, you develop a mindset where, you know, you almost wonder what's outrageous. You know, as long as it's legal and as long as it's possible, it's hardly outrageous. So this is how, in answer to your question, when you create a culture with a team, you know, where people are just really motivated and wanting to do a little better and wanting to be part of something that maybe makes a difference or that gets noticed, then you're a little step closer to excellence. So we talk a lot. You know, we share a lot, we share experiences. So I will be on holiday in a week's time, so I'll be away for 2 weeks, but I will, of course, travel and come back with stories and experiences, good and bad. So those we will share. So there's a really transparent and inclusive culture.
Okay. And for you personally, where does that drive come from to be excellent? Is that something that you've always had?
You know, I have that in certain parts of my life. I'm not like an overly driven person with everything. So I think you need to be a little bit relaxed in this world as well, because otherwise, how would you live? But you see, I really believe that if you do what you love, then that almost comes naturally. And I, you know, I have chosen this profession really very consciously. I just knew and I felt that this is what I want to do. I wanted to do hospitality. I wanted to run a hotel one day, but I knew that when I was 19.
Yes.
And so this is just something that excites me and that I genuinely love and that I'm very passionate about. And I think that's where that drive comes from. So if you and I would now go for a 10K run, you know, you're very welcome to win. It's, so there is a different ambition.
Yes.
So this really means a lot to me.
That's really interesting, because one of the things I write about is that if you can nurture some of these skills, or all the seven skills, then you are much more likely to do work that you love and to have purpose in your life, to have meaning in your life. So I think being able to find something that you really love to do is a great gift that you were able to know that at a young age.
Yeah, I agree. And that's also how we select people, because you can imagine with 500 people doing something that is never done, you know, because what we do today, we start all over tomorrow.
Yes.
Every day we have about 100 arrivals, 100 departures. This suite looks very perfect now, but when we're out of here, somebody will move in. Tomorrow it has to be done again. So when we select people, we need to find people who really want to be here. I mean, if this business, if you just do it to do a job, it's hard. But if you do it because you like it, it's a joy and a pleasure.
Yeah. And perhaps effortless, maybe, too.
And effortless, exactly. Yeah.
So you mentioned earlier, before we recorded, about a model of excellence.
Yeah, because when you, I mean, maybe we can talk a little bit more about how do you get this into 500 people, because, you know, hotels go beyond just checking in, checking out, serving breakfast and so on. I mean, there's, of course, it's a whole business. This is almost 300-bedroom hotels with a number of restaurants and so on. So there is also money involved, and there needs to, of course, be a bottom line. And we have a lot of different products, and service and happiness is, of course, also one of our products, but it's very intangible because it's a mood, it's an emotion, it's a feeling. So you know, and then sometimes I say to the team, you need to make people feel better. And then they look at me like, yeah, but they don't feel bad. Yeah, but you don't have to feel bad in order to feel better. You just need to feel a little better when you leave, and you need to have a reason to come back. So these are very broad and global statements, which maybe just put people a little bit into a frame of mind where this excellence can come from. But then if you operate a hotel and it's busy every day, you have 200 breakfasts, 100 afternoon teas, busy checking in, checking out in restaurants, sometimes you need to make things a little more tangible. And, you know, there's this old management saying, you can only manage what you can measure. And how do you want to measure service? Of course, you can have mystery shopping tests, but it's only ever a snapshot. It's only ever one moment in time. So in order to make it a bit more measurable, we came up with a little model that we share with the staff, and instead of calling it service, we're calling it operational excellence. Because operational excellence actually also includes behind the scenes and not just the person in front of the guest. Because I think it's a really important thing to notice that excellence isn't only happening in the moment where you as a consumer get the excellence. There are a number of elements behind the scenes that have to happen in order for that one colleague to perform. So in operational excellence, we then break down into technical excellence, aesthetic excellence, and emotional excellence, because those are all contributors for people to enjoy service and walk away with a meaningful memory or a great experience. Do you want me to elaborate on that?
No, I love that. I love the idea of a model of excellence.
Yeah, well, because if you think about it a little bit, if you're sitting in a restaurant and you want to get great service or excellent service, there are technical elements. There's like the hotel schools teach us, is the cutlery in the right place? Are you served from the right? You know, just very technical elements. But if it's freezing cold, or if the music is too loud, or if the waiter looks horrible, or you can't understand a word, then these are aesthetic elements that can actually ruin the otherwise perfect experience. So just this sensitivity towards aesthetics as well, you know, how we use our language, how we mirror our guests' behaviors, that the lighting is right, the music is right, you know, that our uniforms are prim and proper, so that it's pleasing on the eye. I think they contribute to service experiences. And so does the emotional excellence, because that's, of course, where you actually probably build the relationships for people to become loyal and come back and actually like it in their hearts. I mean, it's not easy. Empathy, intuition. But it's all contributing to excellence. By telling our teams that, you make them aware, and you suddenly move something to the forefront of their minds that they may otherwise not think about. And I'm not saying that anyone dilly-dallies along, because nobody ever should, but sometimes there is just a routine in life, and I don't think you can blame anyone when they do 100 afternoon teas every day, that after a few weeks maybe there is a certain routine. But this awareness of these individual excellence factors and this drive to make people's day and treat everybody as if it's their birthday today, you need to talk about this, otherwise people forget.
And also, I think what you're saying as well is it's about very much being in the moment and being very present, because that takes the routine
away
from it, doesn't it?
Yeah, and also it brings an alertness and a focus. So, you know, of course we're striving for perfection here, normal. I mean, people pay a lot, and obviously nobody comes here for mistakes. But can I put my hand on my heart and say that we never have a glitch? Of course we do. I mean, we have people working here. Everything is delivered through people, so sometimes things go wrong. But you know, it's interesting. Mostly it goes wrong when people aren't focused, aren't briefed properly, didn't do their homework in terms of preparing for maybe something that isn't the norm. Yeah, it has a lot to do with focus. So being alert to your point and living in the moment and being aware of what's happening around you is so much better for excellence.
I think, and that probably applies across a whole number of industries. So I want to ask you something else. I know, I'm aware that you started your career with an apprenticeship, and this is an opportunity that I think is undervalued in the UK. And so I want to ask you what you feel that experience has given you and how it's impacted your life going through the apprenticeship process.
In hindsight, I liked it very much. At the time, I have to say I didn't think it through too much, because I was born in Germany and that's just the way you start your professional life there in certain professions. I don't know if I ever told you that I had a little bit of a predicament, because I actually started to study medicine and I stopped because it wasn't for me. I just knew I wanted to do this. But this job starts with an apprenticeship, and I felt it was a really solid foundation, because for two and a half years, it depends a little bit on the school you went to before. So for 2 years, I just went through every single department in the hotel, from the kitchen to housekeeping, to reception, to event organization, restaurants, back of house, everything. And first of all, it helps you to find your talent a little bit in a very sort of protected program, because you're just going through the departments, and if you like one very much, you can find that out, and if you don't like another one so much, then that's fine as well, and you didn't make a mistake. So I would really recommend it, and we have a number of apprentices working here at the Corinthia. We're in very close contact with hotel schools to take interns, and I think it's a very good scheme, because I guess it doesn't really matter what you do. At the heart of what we do is an operation and is a core product, and to know how that works. In hotels in particular, I really do not believe that you can manage a hotel not knowing the operation. So
Yes.
I can only, I mean, as you can imagine, I very much encourage young people to come to this industry. And it's yes. really something that's very close to my heart mm. because I sometimes mm. feel the parents are maybe the ones who are preventing young mm-hmm. people to come mm-hmm. into this industry for some reputational mm-hmm. issues. Mm-hmm. But it honestly is such fun, and we do a normal 40-hour week like everybody
yeah,
else.
And, no, I think it's great. I think it's great. I think we in the UK particularly, it's about going to university. Although I think that's changing because it's becoming expensive, and I think yeah. the tide is turning, and I think the value of apprenticeships is becoming more visible, which
yes,
is good.
Which is good. And, you know, I think university education is also very important. And in this business, like in any other business, of course you need a university degree if you want to run a hotel.
Mm.
It's a multi-million pound business where you have a lot of people responsibility. But mm. here at the Corinthia, we say we do everything with our heart, head and hands. And that's actually really quite nice, because not everybody wants to always only work with their head. You know,
yes.
there are a lot
yes.
of people who are just born with very talented hands, and
yes.
they can work in yeah. our kitchens, or they can be engineers. Mm. I mean, there are hotels are just so versatile.
Mm. Well, thank you so much. Now, is there anything else you'd like to tell our listeners about the Corinthia London? And, you know, is there anything they should know about? What are the restaurants like? What else is there that they could come to?
Oh my God, like how much time do I have? But guess what? It is one of my favorite hotels in the world. But there are others. And I think this is really fun about hotels, when you can discover something that you like very mm. much. And I think if you walk through hotels with open eyes, you can discover a lot of those elements. Because there are, in fact, people behind those hotels who try to make them very special. And that's, of course, what we try to do here as well. I mean, when we got Tom Carriage in, he's mm. operating one of our restaurants, that was a very purposeful decision. I mean, that wasn't just a random choice. And I love that restaurant. It's just, it seems like a wonderful party to be in there. You know, it's really fantastic. And Andre Garrett is our executive chef. He's doing the food in the rest of the hotel. I mean, I don't think I should keep our spa a secret. The spa is a wonderful place.
Hadn't thought about the spa.
I know it's 35,000 square feet, so it's spread over four floors, and you have mm. an entire floor dedicated to the beautiful treatment rooms, then one to fitness, and one to pools and saunas and steam rooms and so on. And if you're still not excited,
that's amazing. I'm going to have to come back for the
yeah,
spa.
Yeah, you have to come back to the spa.
Oh.
I would just love to see people, and we would love to welcome everyone.
Great. Well, thank you. Thank you so much for talking to us today. I really appreciate your time, and it's been lovely to spend some time with you. Thank you.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.